As you know, the chapter on integration centers around finding the area under a curve. But so far, we've learned about two different things in this chapter that seem totally disjointed. And you may have even had questions about this. You know, how are these two things compatible? What do they even have to do with one another? On the one hand, we started the chapter learning about these guys called antiderivatives. And so we got pretty good at them. They were, you know, especially right on the heels of studying the derivatives chapter. And basically what these guys are, basically the opposite of a derivative. You know, if you have a function 2x, for instance, then we can very easily take its derivative and get something like 2. But that's not what an antiderivative is. An antiderivative asks what function, if you took its derivative, would give you 2x. And so, you know, after some study, we figured out that the function would be x squared. X squared's derivative would be 2x. There's a whole list of rules that go along with this idea of finding antiderivatives. We call this indefinite integration. We even have a symbol for it. If you want to find the antiderivative of 2x, you would put this tall S-looking symbol, and you'd put 2x dx, and then the answer to that, the antiderivative, would be x squared plus c. So this is a whole family of functions. The plus c represents any constant. X squared plus 1, x squared plus 2, minus 3, minus 7, plus 12, you know, any function that has x squared with a constant on the end, because the constant would go away if you took its derivative, and for any of these guys, you would get 2x. But if you actually thought about it, and you may have been thinking this during the video, what does that have to do with area under a curve? But seemingly absolutely nothing. We never mentioned anything in regards to area under a curve. But then on the other hand, we abruptly switched. We did not talk about antiderivatives at all, and instead we started talking about definite integrals, and that was directly related to the area under a curve from a starting point to an ending point. And so the way we write this is a very similar looking symbol, this tall S with the function that you're integrating, dx, and you write from A to B as the limits of integration, and this means area, right? So this means area under the curve, and this guy means antiderivative or indefinite integral. And again, no connection. There's a big disconnect here between these two ideas. And what makes it even worse is it's fine if they're disjointed or not connected, but why would you use such similar notation between these two guys? The only difference is this, you're writing A to B, and this you're not. And it makes a big difference, obviously. This is a family of functions. This is a numerical answer, which represents the actual area under the curve. So what's the connection? Well, here's the big video that connects these two ideas together. So this is probably one of the most important topics you'll see in all of Calculus 1. This is called the fundamental theorem of calculus. All right, and what it's going to do is it's going to help us find the exact area under a curve, not an approximation, but the exact area under the curve using calculus. And surprise, surprise, the way it does it is it uses these guys called antiderivatives to help us do that. Okay, so here we go. Some restrictions on your function to begin. The function has to be a continuous function. There can't be any breaks in it or asymptotes or anything like that in order to do this. And it has to be integrable, meaning you have to be able to take its antiderivative. Like 2x would be an integrable function, but there are other functions that are not integrable on a closed interval from A to B. All right, so the first half of this we already know. The area under this curve would be the integral from A to B of f of x dx. And that right there, you say, well, Devin, I already knew that. That's called a definite integral. That means the exact area under the curve. But if you've noticed, we've never learned a practical way to find that. We understand the idea in theory, but in the last video that we covered, the only way we were able to actually get that answer was using a calculator. We couldn't do it by hand. Well, in this video, the fundamental theorem of calculus explains how you actually go about finding this by hand. Let's let f of x, I probably should have written this up here before, let's let capital F of x be the antiderivative like it was on the last page, antiderivative of this function right here. So whatever function that is, will let capital F be the antiderivative of little f of x. Well, you can determine the area under the curve of little f using the antiderivative. Here's what you do. You start by plugging in the upper limit, namely b, into the capital F function. So we get capital F of b minus, and then you plug in the lower limit of integration, that's lowercase a, the starting limit, plug that into the function. So I have capital F of a, and then you take their difference, you subtract them. And what comes out of that is the exact area under the curve. So the antiderivative is a function, and so you're plugging in b the first time and a the second time, and you're getting two numerical values, and then you're subtracting. Now, one thing I'll mention is in doing this, you can actually ignore this plus c right here. And you say, well, Devin, how can you ignore the plus c? Well, the reason we can actually ignore it is, let's say that the first one had a plus c and the second antiderivative had a plus c. If you're subtracting these two guys, the plus c minus this c, they would wind up canceling anyway. So in general, we don't write a plus c when we're doing these definite integrals here. But that's huge. I hope you understand the magnitude of this statement. We can find the area under any curve function without any geometry formulas, without any approximations, using antiderivatives. This was proven sometime around in the 1600s or so, and so it's a pretty involved proof, but it's, thankfully we have this, you know, under our tool belt. Now, what's the notation? Because, you know, this could get kind of long. You know, given a problem like this, you might have to go find the antiderivative over here and then plug in a and b over here and then subtract them down here. You have a page full of work just trying to find the area under the curve. So fortunately, there's some condensed notation. When you're integrating a definite integral from a to b of little f, what we typically do is we'll write the antiderivative just with x's and everything, no plus c, but just write the antiderivative down. And then you put a bracket on the right-hand side with a little a and a b. Not this s symbol and not on the left-hand side. You put it on the right-hand side. And this is shorthand for telling the reader, okay, now that you found the antiderivative, go ahead and plug in b and plug in a, and then subtract those two quantities. That way it's nice and neat and concise, and you don't have work written all over the place. Okay. All right, so the example we're going to try is actually an example I did a couple of videos ago with an approximation. I did I believe it was a right-hand sum of the area under the square root function from 1 to 4. So I'd encourage you to go back and watch that video. And I made a comment that the area, the answer that we got was not exact, because we actually had these rectangles built in here that had the error and whatnot. But we're going to try to do it exactly today, by hand, no calculator. So here we go. Square root of x, that's our little f. That's our function that we're integrating. And so what's the antiderivative of the square root of x? Well, let's see here. If f of x, now I'm probably writing more than is necessary this time, just while we're getting accustomed to this stuff. But in general, we won't have to write quite so much. So what would the antiderivative of this guy be? Well, if you remember your integration rules, you would add one to the exponent as opposed to subtracting one, because we're not taking a derivative, we're taking an integral. It's the other direction. So we get x to the 3/2 with a 2/3 out front, like that. So this integral here will be 2/3 x to the 3/2 bracket, right, with a 1 and a 4, and this means we're about to plug in 4, and we're about to plug in 1, and we're about to subtract those two quantities. So if you plug in 4, 4 to the 3/2 is 8, and then you have 8 times 2 is 16, so this would be 16/3. Then you plug in a 1, 1 to the 3/2 is 1, 1 times 2/3 is 2/3. And we're going to subtract those. And make sure you do it in the correct order. First you plug in B, then you plug in A, and then you subtract. So this would be 16 thirds minus 2 thirds would be 14 thirds, which is approximately, let's see, what would that be? 4.6 repeating, right? 4.666 repeating or so. So this would be the exact perfect area under the curve, no approximations whatsoever. And we did that completely by hand using the fundamental theorem of calculus. You take the antiderivative, capital F of B minus capital F of A, and we're done. Now, just to convince you that this really is correct, I did this on my TI calculator right before I recorded this video. Here's the square root function right here, and the area from 1 to 4, you see this little integral symbol here, the area was 4.6 repeating. So we know it is correct, and you can see it here. This is a perfect area under the curve. So we'll do some harder examples in the next videos, but hopefully this gives you a good introduction to the fundamental theorem of calculus.